Today I want to talk more about SSH tunneling. I want to talk about SSH tunnels with remote port forwarding and SSH tunnels with dynamic port forwarding that you might also know as a SOCKS proxy. We will discuss why they can be useful and we will also see how to configure each of them. We will also see a tool called AutoSSH and why we should consider using it. We already saw in previous episode how to create an SSH tunnel with local port forwarding. And we configured then a basic SSH connection, we configured the users, we then configured SSH tunnel that was connecting to public IP on the remote server. And then we could use that tunnel to access other applications listening on other ports on that server. And the link to that previous material should be displayed right now in the top right corner. In that example though, remote server had a public IP and it had port 22 for SSH opened on that public IP. But what if you want to access some internal network where those servers don't have public IPs directly configured on them? What if you want to take your laptop for a holiday, for example, and access some devices or some resources at home while being away? By default, you will not be able to access them because at home you have something called network address translation in place. And I will talk about it more in a minute. Or different scenario maybe. If you are an administrator at work and you have to arrange a connection for some third-party company to be able to access internal web server or internal application on your servers, but those servers don't even have public IP addresses configured. They are also behind that NAT solution. That is something where SSH tunnel with remote port forwarding can help. But before we talk about SSH tunnels, let's first see how this network address translation works to understand what problem we are solving here. As I said, at home you already have that network address translation device, even though it might not be obvious, but it's usually that little box that you got from your internet service provider, and I know we all call it a router, but in fact, this device also performs network address translation for you. That means all devices you have at home will have their private IP addresses assigned by that box, and that's done by a separate feature on that box. It's called DHCP, Dynamic Host Configuration Protocol. But anyways, if you want to access something from the internet, like YouTube or Facebook, the Network Address Translation Service will translate your private IP address to a public IP when that traffic is initiated from inside of your network. The public IP is usually on the one port of that device, or it might be even configured further inside your internet provider network. But anyways, your private IP address simply has to be translated somewhere to public IP address, so you are able to reach anything on that public network called the internet. And then, on the way back, when the response from that Facebook or YouTube or whatever, when the response comes back in, this device will swap again that public IP back to private IP of that computer that initiated that request. Because this NAT device keeps track of who sends what request and what was that device's private IP address. At work, you might have a router or firewall that will do the same network address translation. The only difference might be that this firewall might have several public IP addresses assigned to it, and will be able to handle many more concurrent sessions than your device at home. But overall, it's the same solution. And then again, if your infrastructure is in the cloud, then you have some type of NAT gateway that you have to configure, and all that traffic will be translated to a public IP address for you. And that NAT gateway will be managed for you by your cloud provider. So you just state that you need one, and everything else will be done for you automatically in the background. But in all those examples, the traffic has to be initiated from inside. It is not possible by default to initiate the traffic from outside. Because if you did that, your NAT device would simply not know where to forward it. It only knows where to forward the traffic that was initiated from inside of your network. So the solution to that is either to configure port forwarding on that firewall or router that performs NAT, and then you would give the device instructions on what to do with the traffic that is initiated from outside. But other option is to use that reverse SSH tunneling, or SSH tunnel with reverse port forwarding, it's called. All that means is that one of our servers will need to initiate the SSH tunnel to remote server, and then that remote server will be able to use that tunnel to access other servers or other services that run inside our internal network. And because this traffic is initiated from our network, from our SSH server, there is nothing that we have to configure on any other device. No firewall or NAT configuration has to be changed. I've got some servers prepared already. Let me just SSH to them. So I've got remote server. I've got SSH server. And I've got one backend server called server 1. The first thing we have to check if we can establish basic SSH connection between our SSH server and the remote server. And in that previous episode, we went through that process, how to actually configure that, so I will not repeat it here. I will basically SSH as user Ubuntu to the remote server. And you can see, I can do that. I'm already on a remote server. And if I exit, I am back on a local SSH server. That means I am ready to build an SSH tunnel with reverse port forwarding. Let me just arrow up. No, one second. Let me clear everything. That's better, isn't it? Okay, so arrow up. That was my command, but I don't want just SSH. I want to use dash n, which says do not run that command, only use it as a SSH tunneling method, and then dash r, I specify remote port on that remote server I want to listen on. It will be port 8888. I mean, it can be any port you want, but for this instance, I will use 8888. And then what will be the local IP and port? I will use localhost. I mean, that's not IP, that's the domain, but it's basically the same as if I said 127.0.0.1. This is the localhost. And then the port, I will use port 80. And let me show you, let me just press enter. Let me show you why I chose port 80. I configured each of those servers. I installed Nginx on it, and every single server runs a simple website. So for example, if I go to backend server, server 1, if I do curl localhost on port 80, you can see response from Nginx that this is response from server 1, and I am on server 1. If I go to remote server and do the same, I also have response from Nginx, but this time, this is response from remote server. So when I run that local command, it gives me local response from remote server that I'm already on. And on SSH server, well, this tunnel already runs, so let me open another session. I will SSH to SSH server again. And if I run that command, you can see that SSH server also has Nginx, and the response is, this response is from SSH server. I hope that makes sense. So this tunnel is now running. That means on a remote server, if I clear again, we already run that command, localhost on port 80. Let's maybe run it again. I get response from remote server, but clear again. If I do curl localhost on port 8888, this is what I specified here. Now when I press enter, I get response from SSH server. That means this remote server can use that port and tunnel the HTTP traffic, which is running on different port. On SSH server, it's running on port 80. It can go through that SSH tunnel, grab the information, and pull it back. So note that only port 22 is used between those two servers, and only that remote server, or third-party server, let's call it, needs to have this port 22 open. Locally, on SSH server, you don't even need to do that. So you don't need public IP directly on SSH server, you can be behind NAT, and you don't need to open any ports, because if traffic is initiated from inside, a rule will be automatically created to allow return traffic to that SSH server. So you basically don't need any ports open on the SSH server. But let's now extend that connection a little bit. I'll go to SSH server, I will Control C, and now let's say from that remote server, I want to go through SSH server and fetch something that is running on server 1. Like for example, I want to reach that Nginx server. How would I do that? I can run that command again, but instead of using localhost, I don't need localhost. Let's say remote port will be still 8888, so this remote server can use that port to connect to this one, but I don't want this connection to terminate here on localhost. I want it to go further to that server 1. So we can check IP address on server 1. IP address, let's say. I can see it's configured with IP address of 10.0.1.216. So I can simply use this in my command instead of localhost. 10.0.1.216. That's all I need. Let me run it again. Let's click enter. And now I will just rerun my command. Curl localhost 8888 on remote server. But what response I have now? This is response from server 1. So that works, but for that to work, let me just control C this connection first. For that connection to work, you have to bear in mind that server 1 has to have a rule that allows traffic on port 80 from SSH server. Means I should be able on SSH server to run command like curl, then IP address of that server 1, of that backend server, and then port 80. And I get response from server 1, so that's perfectly fine. But on this occasion, this server 1 has to accept connections on port 80 from SSH server. But note that you don't need SSH connection between SSH server and server 1. This is not running over SSH connection. SSH tunnel exists only between SSH server and remote server, and then as a plain HTTP traffic is forwarded further to server 1. The last thing I want to mention is that this tunnel on SSH server, it is configured from inside my network, yes, from SSH server. That means if this tunnel goes down, both teams, like on the local server and on the remote server, those two teams would have to cooperate to have that tunnel re-established if something went wrong, if that tunnel went down. And that's where a tool called AutoSSH can help. So if I go to my SSH server, I control C that, and AutoSSH is something you need to install first. Because if I run AutoSSH, you can see command AutoSSH cannot be found, but can be installed with one of those commands. So I will use this one maybe. And that's all it is. Then I clear again. And now, instead of running SSH, I simply run AutoSSH. What AutoSSH does, it will monitor the status of this tunnel, and if anything goes down, it will automatically try to re-establish the connection for you. So it takes care that this tunnel is always up and running. And it also means it's simply one less thing for you to take care of. So now it's running, and if I curl again, as you can see, I get the response again. Fine, I hope that all makes sense. So we can now move to SSH tunnel with dynamic port forwarding, also known as dynamic SSH tunnel or as SOCKS proxy. If you configure reverse port forwarding or if you configure local port forwarding, in all of those scenarios, we have to specify local port and the remote port. And you know what? This solution is not very scalable. Or even though I can actually configure multiple ports, I didn't mention that, but I could run something like -r different remote port and different local port. And I could keep doing that, but it's still not very scalable. It's very static configuration. That's why we have yet another solution called SSH tunnel with dynamic port forwarding. And let me show you how it works and how to configure it. And it's super easy, because you simply assign a port on SSH server to listen on, and that basically creates the SOCKS proxy server that you can use to tunnel all traffic that you want, really. So the command is SSH, -D, capital D, for dynamic port. Then the port I want to assign, let's say it's again 8888, and then N, this means we want to use it for port forwarding, and it's again credentials for server I want to create that tunnel to, which was Ubuntu at remote server. I will press enter, and the same like with reverse tunneling, this SSH server doesn't even need public IP directly on the server. It can be behind that network address translation solution, where it will get the public IP from. And then the tunnel is created to a remote location, and this SSH server can tunnel the traffic through the SSH tunnel. What you have to do, you have to just point your application to that SOCKS proxy server, to that SSH tunnel. And once it gets there, it will be forwarded to remote location. And what I mean by that is, let me maybe exit this. I will SSH to SSH server. Clear. So basically two terminals, but on the same server, on SSH server. If I run curl ifconfigme, this command returns public IP address that this server uses when it reaches the internet. And it might be directly on this server, but it can be also the IP address that NAT gateway gives us. But now, if I run command curl again, then I tell it to use proxy, and then I instruct it what type of proxy I want to use, and this dynamic tunneling supports SOCKS proxy in version 4 and version 5. So I will say SOCKS 5, and for me it's here directly on localhost 8888. And now I want to run that command ifconfigme. So it's basically curl ifconfigme, but now I'm going through that proxy. Let me press enter. As you can see, I have different public IP address. And guess who is configured with that public IP address? It's the remote server. So the traffic is simply going through the SSH tunnel up to remote server, and only there it's decrypted. It's forwarded even further towards the internet, and on the internet is seen as traffic coming from remote server. But what you can do now, you can also instruct other applications, or even applications or on other internal servers, to start using this proxy. And all that traffic from back-end server applications can be forwarded to this SOCKS proxy server and tunneled further to the remote server. And note that on this SSH server I didn't specify any local or remote ports for application. The port you specify is the SOCKS proxy port that SSH server listens on, and it can tunnel any other port or application you want to put through that proxy. And how you configure the application to use proxy varies between the applications. For example, I can show you the Firefox. You have to click simply that menu in top right corner, go to settings. If you scroll down to the very bottom, you have network settings, and this is where you configure your proxy server. But if you want to proxy any other type of traffic, then you might have to look up the documentation for that particular application, how to proxy the traffic, how you can set up the proxy for it. So it's a very powerful feature, and proxy opens loads of possibilities, but for today I just wanted to show you basic configuration for that dynamic port forwarding solution. So yes, I hope all that makes sense, and I thank you for watching.